Hey guys, this is Mel, and I'm back to talk about the 100, episode 509, titled Sic Semper Tyrannis, which premiered Tuesday, July 10th, 2018 on the CW. I'm recording, it's about 10:10 right now for me, so it's been an hour and 10 minutes since the episode has ended at its new time at 8 p.m. Huge spoiler alert, if you haven't seen the episode already, please go do so first, then come back and see what I have to say about the episode. Otherwise, my other video reminders are on screen, so take a moment to remind yourselves of those. Seems like it's been a while since I've done a video, but anyways, I'm gonna try to do this in 15 minutes. Before I start that, I completely forgot, or I don't know how this missed my attention, but I need to talk about 508 for a second, more specifically Bellamy and Clark, because apparently when I first watched the episode and I first watched the scene, first did the recording for 508, it did not occur to me that Octavia's comment about Bellamy coming back to plead for Clark's life, and she refers to her as another traitor that he loves. Did not occur to me that he was talking that they were talking about Clark. I thought they were talking about Echo for some stupid reason, because quote is on screen, "I can't let you kill Clark O," and then here we go again, pleading for the life of a traitor who you love. And he doesn't say anything. He doesn't refute that. He doesn't clarify. He just gives her this look. So, like, for some reason, I thought she was bringing Echo back into this, like, as a reminder, like, you've already done this before. Why play the song and dance again? But then it was actually about Clark she was referring to as being the second person he loves who turned traitor, who he's trying to plead life for. So it was like, I can't believe I missed that. So it was just, I have to talk about it now. And the fact that just blew my mind away. So many videos popped up with people adding that scene to any Bellark videos and stuff like that. So I'm kind of sad that I missed it, yet overjoyed that there was no refuting or any clarification made for Bellamy's reaction. He didn't clarify which one they were talking about. He just gave her a look, is like, okay, I see what you get there. Having us get the implication of whether or not we want to take it however we will. Because initially I thought it was Echo, but it's really about Clark, so I'll stick with it being about Clark. But I just like that. And then he immediately went to change the subject. And the funny, or not, I don't shouldn't say the funny thing is though, but the fact that what really is the takeaway, I guess, is the fact that because Clark's life is on the line, Bellamy went and took that extra step that he's been fighting the whole episode against Clark for, and that was getting Octavia out of the way, and which was to save Clark's life. He ended up poisoning Octavia himself so that they could take the they could surrender to Dioza. They could have done that at the very beginning of the episode. They didn't have to kill Cooper or anyone like that. But when Clark's life was on the line, he made the move he swore he wouldn't do at the beginning of the episode. So that's a huge thing right there. So anyways, I've spoke about enough for 508. Let's get right into 509. 15 minutes, clock has started. So timeline-wise, I'm thinking it is the next day after the events of 508. And that is, or at least it's not long after Octavia was poisoned by Bellamy. That's my impression of it. We don't know specifically how it was she was discovered to have been unconscious. From the looks of it, they didn't find Bellamy with Octavia. Or I don't know, maybe they did, and it's just certain people weren't there when that discovery happened. So, not sure exactly. Maybe it's been a few hours. I don't know. But enough for a diagnosis to happen with Jackson. And I'm rambling, sorry. Episode reminder though, I'm going to say we get the next ascension versus a civil war within Allegis. The episode objective, I'm going to say, is we're stopping a war versus starting another one. So we kind of have one trying to start one trying to end one. But anyways, you'll get it. So huge episode breakdown storyline-wise. We have two in both sectors. We got two happening in Wong Crew. We have two happening in the Shallow Valley, or Eden, if you would. I picked up on the fact that within Wong Crew, we get the mystery of Octavia's poisoning. They're trying to find out who did it. In the end, Bellamy, Indra, and Gaia are arrested as traitors for the event. Also, we get Maddie's ascension. Maddie does eventually accept the flame, and she does wake up, but she runs with Clark before she can officially complete the ascension and become the new commander. And since Octavia is awake, she is in control as Blood Reyna still. So there's that. Moving on to Shallow Valley, though, we have the two storylines in which we have the first one being Dioza wanting Abby to cure only specific prisoners that Dioza clears, which eventually gets back to McCreary, which accepts him, upsets him and his men because of that divide. And there's kind of goes towards more tensions rising. So there's that. Because of that, though, our arcers inside Allegis, so that's Murphy, Raven, Umori, and Echo, they decide to weaken the enemy, which is Allegis, by starting a civil war among them, and they take advantage of the divide between Dioza and McCreary. This leads to McCreary taking hold of Abby, Dioza and her people fleeing Allegis, or the main camp in Allegis, for safety. McCreary has demanded for Shaw to be found so that he can use his pilot skills to take advantage and kill the traitors among them, as well as the Wong Kru army that's set to march on them. So there's that. Because McCreary also has Abby, Kane is determined to stay behind and rescue her, and Murphy has offered to help. So there's that. That was a lot longer than I wanted it to be, but moving on to last moments of the episode show Octavia breaking down when she's behind closed doors after sentencing Bellamy and Indra into the arena to their death. Specifically, it's meant to look like Bellamy, though, because he doesn't stop looking at her until the door is finally shut and stops the connection between them. So there's that. Tidbit-wise, though, we got a few of them here. It was confirmed in this episode that Dioza is having McCreary's daughter, and it looks like he had no idea about it. So it must be that she was hiding the pregnancy from everybody, and then only Abby and Kane might have been the only ones in the know about it. So there's that right there. We got Echo continuing to play the part of Dioza's spy, and she uses that part to her advantage to help Murphy kickstart the little civil war thing going on. Also, we get Kane helping to build a settlement further south of within Shadow Valley for everybody to kind of live into later on. Dayoza also did mention that she wanted everybody to have a piece of their own land. Not sure if that was true or if that was just a lie to placate the McCreary's men. So don't know about that. We get Miller, Jackson, and Nyla all proving their loyalty towards Octavia. When they try to take actions against the traitors trying to dethrone her. We also see fighting skills among the alleged prisoners, specifically with Dioza's fighting skills when she takes on three men. Takes on three men and she wins for the most part until McCreary gets her in a chokehold. But she can hold her own for sure. I was very impressed. Also, we get McCreary willing to keep his deal with Murphy, telling him that if you are telling me the truth, and then you better get your people and leave before things get bloody. Though we did say that if Murphy was lying about the intel, then the blood's gonna be his that he shed. So there's that. Also, we find out that Maddie was the same age that Lexa was when she had ascended to being the commander. So apparently, her age is the common or the average age, I guess, that a commander comes into power. So there's that. And then let's just put that into perspective here, because that means at Maddie's age, a bunch of Nightbloods her age would have to fight each other in a conclave, and then the winner, which was Lexa at that time, came out to become the commander. That's just kids fighting each other. That's crazy. But anyways, let's move on to ship status very quickly. Bellamy and Clark, I did mention a bunch of it for 508, but 509 is when we take a turn in the opposite, where we get them both betraying each other to protect their loved ones. We get Bellamy portraying Clark by using Maddie to become the new commander so that he could protect his family, and that is in the form of Echo, Raven, Murphy, and Amori. And then we have Clark betraying Bellamy so that she can get Maddie to safety and away from Octavia. Also, you could push it that Clark was willing to kill Octavia to protect Maddie. So they have their both distinct families that they've said in this episode, when in the previous episode of 508, they were standing united as a unit. So a little on the fence there with those two about where I should fall, but yeah, but that's where they're currently at right now. They're at odds with each other. And then Raven and Shaw, we have him agreeing to leave with her, after she mentions that, well, if he doesn't leave with her, then she's gonna have to kill him. So there's that. But then he also explains that how he wishes that they would have a regular conversation without life or death situations coming into play. So there's that. With Kane and Dioza, we get that he's very protective of her because he knows that without her, peace is not possible. So there's that, which makes sense because if McCreary was in the lead, well, he wants to kill everybody who goes against him. So there's that. Also with Indra and Octavia, we got them both stating that Indra fears what Octavia has become, while Octavia is ashamed of the cowardice Indra is showing. Though Indra has come into some hindsight over the fact that a lot of her guidance has what led to Octavia being this feared leader. They did both mention something happening within the Dark Year. It's apparently something taboo that they shouldn't be talking about. But later on, I think it's episode 511, we're gonna get more insight into what happened in the Dark Year. So anyways, moving on to a most shocking moment of the episode. I think for me, it would have to be the fact that Clark thought of killing Octavia to save Maddie. I mean, in the promo, it shows Clark donning the cape with the gun pointed. I thought she was going to shoot down some guards and stuff to grant her freedom. No, she's pointing the gun at Octavia, thinking that Maddie's only safe as long as Blood Reyna is no longer alive and ruling Wonkru. So she actually goes in and thinks about executing Blood Reyna, and I was just shocked. I mean, yeah, Clark's in Mama Bear mode, but like, wow. No self-preservation at all within the enemy walls, like, really. But anyways, moving on to top three favorite moments. First favorite for me has to be Bellamy and Clark, despite how they're at odds with each other right now. I did like at the beginning of the episode, they were all about togetherness, how they had a plan of getting their people to safety, going to Shallow Valley together, and living out peace, and then also the promises between each other to protect one another, promising to protect Maddie. All great. They're all finally on the same page. And I really like that, especially after coming off of the high that Bellark left me in for 508. So that was a favorite there. Where they ended up at the end of the episode, I will talk about in my piece. So stay tuned for that, unfortunately. But another favorite of mine has to be the inner workings of Murphy, Raven, Echo, and Amori. It's great to see all four of them back together again. It's great to see how each of them contribute to their escape plan. You have Raven and Amori working on the shock collars. You have Murphy being the troublemaker that he is and igniting the tensions between the two sides of Allegis. And then you have Echo doing the reporting as a spy would to kind of ignite that even further. It was just great to see how they work together because you have all of them very strong, very opinionated people, and you could see that all the ladies want to do things a certain way, and they have their valid reasons why they should do it a certain way. And then once those valid reasons are said, they listen to each other as a to see why, okay, why your way, what's the benefit, and stuff like that. And then you got Murphy. He's trying to keep the peace among the three ladies, and he's trying to remind them that we're on the same side here. Our main goal is to this, this, this. And it was just very interesting to see that, for him to take that moment to kind of remind them of, like, we may be in this situation, but we're still a team here, going for the same thing. So it was just really interesting. I love the four of them. It was really great to see how they played off of each other, really see how they work behind enemy lines. So that was great. And a third favorite moment would have to be Maddie's ascension. Yes, there's a whole bunch of fear behind what it means for Maddie to ascend, but I really like that we got back to the mythology of what it was for to be a grounder, what we were first introduced to originally in season three, and how when Maddie woke up and she started accessing all this old information that she wouldn't have known regardless because Clark wouldn't have known it to tell her, but like all that information about that one grounder and how she went back to the history of his part during Lex's ruling. I thought that was pretty great. I can't wait to see what other capabilities the flame will be giving to Maddie. And it's just a lot of possibilities, especially when you know that Maddie's the same age that Lexa was when she first ascended. I'm really interested to see what Maddie could do and which path she would take now that she's technically having the power of the commanders, essentially. And I'm just wondering how it works for her in her head. Like, what's it like? I mean, we kind of saw what it was like with Clark, but now without that City of Light thing, is it any differently now? So I can't wait to see how that will form further. But moving on to top three peed moments. As I mentioned previously, the ending part for Bellamy and Clark was my peeve, and that was the fact that they betrayed each other. I don't like the fact that Bellamy went back on his promise to Clark and decided to take Maddie to get the flame. That was one betrayal right there. Another betrayal you have is that Clark not only tried to kill Octavia, but then she sided with Octavia to try to get Bellamy's plan dismantled when, in a way, he was kind of doing it not to protect, or Bellamy was trying to ensure Maddie ascended so that Clark could live as well. So it was kind of like, I don't know. But then, like, she slapped him, and then, like, she ended up running away with Maddie, and it's just like a whole snafu of stuff happening with Bellamy and Clark. They're definitely not on the same page anymore. They're definitely not on the same side, essentially. So that's a little disheartening for me, as you know. But then the main peeve about all that was the fact that Clark ran with Maddie. I mean, mainly because, like, yeah, she solely wants to protect her, and I get that. But there was once a time when Clark would have gone back and to rescue Bellamy in this situation. Like, he's arrested and he's set to fight in the arena to his death. There would have been a time, if there was no Maddie in this situation, there would have been a time that Clark would have gone back to try to find a way to get Bellamy out of that situation. Instead, she's running for the hills to protect Maddie, and it's so far off where Bellamy and Clark used to be. And it's just, I hope they get back to the point where they're on the same page once again. And on the same side too. So that was a peeve there from the Bellamy Clark shipper heart that I have. And another peeve of mine is that the efforts to stop the war keep getting derailed. Just when we think we're about to hit something or make something work, it falls apart. And I don't know if I should be impressed that One Crew is so united as it is, or if I should be frustrated that there's no progress in getting to the valley or in getting peace in some way. So that's a peeve there. But moving on to what will I remember most when I look back on this episode, pretty much could say that it's an outbreak of war on many different fronts. So there's that. Moving on to random questions very quickly. The first one is, if Clark didn't take the flame out of Maddie, then why run to begin with? I mean, if Maddie took control of the flame and then took, which would lead to her controlling One Crew, then the war could be stopped because she could surrender. She'd be in that position to do so. But then now I'm wondering, is Clark mainly running because Octavia is still alive, and as long as Octavia is alive, then Maddie is at risk, especially now that she has the flame inside of her. So there's that question there. Another question is, and there's the timer. With the flame inside Maddie, does that mean that Maddie will now have Lex's memories? Is that one way for Clark to reconnect with the memory of her former love? So that'll be something. Again, I mentioned before that I'm interested to see how Maddie takes on the role of commander, or how she processes this ascension. I want to know how she's affected by the flame. I want to know how all that information she retains, how that affects her, how she gets it, how she compartmentalizes it, especially if, like, we have Lexa, who was part of the flame, we have Antari that was part of the flame, we have Becca that was part of the flame. So there's a whole bunch of people also that we don't know about that Maddie will be getting some wisdom from. And just how exactly is it going to be, like, how when Clark went into the City of Light because of the flame, will she be seeing, and she was able to see Lexa like she did, will she be able to see, will Maddie be able to have that type of experience as well? Maybe not in the City of Light, but like that kind of like face-to-face type of thing in her head. I'm wondering. I don't know. I'd like to find out about that. And then last question was, will McCreary still attack Murphy, or will their deal be kept intact? I mean, between Mercury and Murphy, what status do they have between the two of them? Are they still enemies? Are they still deal mates or something? Or what have you? So there's that. Moving on to predictions very quickly. Based off the promo for 5:10, it looks that there are preparations for the arena fight between Bellamy, Indra, and Gaia. This promo reminds me a lot of the Conclave fight that happened in 4:10, when we had Octavia fighting Rowan, Luna, Ilion, all those people for the right to get the bunker. So that's a little, and rightfully so, 5:10, 4:10, right? And rightfully so, huge fights. Anyways, but the synopsis though for 5:10 reads nothing about the arena fight. Instead, it reads that Monty strives to show Wong Crew an alternative to war and to the valley itself. Meanwhile, Abby's health continues to deteriorate along with Mercury's patience. So again, nothing in the synopsis leads to the fact that we're going to get a huge arena fight in the next episode. So that's something there. So I can't wait to see about that. Don't really have anything else to talk about. I will mention though that what next week actually? Yeah, next week, San Diego Comic-Con is set to start. With that, there is going to be a panel for a bunch of TV shows premiering what's to come. Since the 100, it's still airing when Comic-Con happens. I don't know what spoilers they're able to say about season 6, if they're just going to spoil what's going to happen in the remainder of season 5, but I will do a video about what is revealed at San Diego Comic-Con, so I hope you check out that video when it comes. Be on the lookout for that, but I'll still continue with the regular recap videos. So with that said, guys, what did you guys think of the episode? I just blanked for a second there. Wow. What did you guys think of the episode? What did you guys like about it? What do you think is going to happen next? Let me know in the comments down below. Love to hear your own thoughts, theories, and opinions about what you think is to come. Also, don't forget to like this video, subscribe to my channel, check out my other videos if you haven't done so already. If you want, check out my Tumblr page. The link for that is down below. I read blog promos, web clips, quotes, GIFs, synopses, news, all that good stuff, all found in one place. So go check that out. I am behind. Fully aware of that. I plan to take a full day, maybe two, and just solely update Tumblr. It's gonna be a huge binge post of it all. I just gotta find the right days to do it. So check back, be on the lookout. If you want, WordPress account link for that is down below as well. It connects all everything I post online to it. It's more organized over there, but it is still a work in progress. So keep that in mind as well. But otherwise, guys, thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for your patience. I hope you come back next time to see what I have to say about 5:10. Stay tuned for any news about the panel for San Diego Comic Con. And until all that comes out, guys, hope you have a great day, great week, wherever you are. Bye for now.